Father, Lord, we worship you once again. We honor you for this presentation this evening. Lord, we give you the grace for making it possible. Lord, it was difficult for us last week, but today you make your name real in the midst of your church. Be thou exalted above the heaven. Father, Lord, there is none that can deliver out of your hands. When you walk, none can hinder it. Father, Lord, as we look at tonight's topic, that's a life of faith. Lord, grant us faith to stand in your path, to direct your vision, to guide your footstep. Lord, show us mercy, kindness, and grace, that in everything your name alone might be glorified. For in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Brethren, tonight we are having another topic. We use this opportunity to look at a topic which is called faith. A life of faith. This teaching is under our Open House Fellowship. If you are joining us for the first time, this is CGF Open House Fellowship. CGF Open House Fellowship. We meet every Tuesday by 6 p.m. By 8 p.m. local time, Nigeria time, and 7 p.m. Swedish time. Brethren, if you miss any of our program, try and go to our website at cgfnslogin.r. cgfnslogin.r. Today is another wonderful day. We are going to be looking at another exciting topic. We see faith. Faith. Our text will be taken from the book of Hebrews chapter 11. Let us read Hebrews 11 before we start. I just want to read Hebrews chapter 11 from verse 1. I read from verse 1. By faith we understand. What do we understand by faith? He said, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. When we're talking about faith, we're talking about substance. And when we say the word substance, what is substance? Substance are things that can be handled. Things that are tangible are substance. Substance is a product of faith. But how is substance a product of faith? Many of us believe that faith is a belief system. But faith is actually proven by work. Faith is actually proven by work. Because for your faith to come alive, the work of faith must be shown. So how is faith a substance? For example, somebody is sick. You believe in God. Though belief is not visible physically. You cannot see belief. You believe that God healing can come to the person. You believe that that healing that you have just sent can come. And because you believe in healing, healing is mandatory in the life of that believer. And so what is faith, therefore? Faith is the substance of that belief and the evidence of things not known or not seen. And what is that evidence? The evidence is the healing. People see the visible healing after your prayer. Somebody is dead. People are crying. You come with a word. After, with confidence, praying for the sick or the dead, and they come back alive. What is the substance? The substance is the person risen from the dead. So when we talk about faith, we are talking of material substance, evidence of things. things that you have not seen. And that is what we talk about faith. In Christianity, many of us have not seen God at any point or at any time. But the only proof we have that God exists is faith. Confidence in his work, the evidence of work he left behind that we can see, touch, and handle. So when we are talking about substance, substance are things that are tangible. Faith is not an invisible object. Faith manifests in the spiritual, but bring material to reality. That is what we are going to be studying today. I will be your teacher for tonight. My name is Missionary Collins Adoge. I'll be your teacher for tonight. Brethren, I'm sorry for the delay in starting. If you are joining us for the first time, this program happens every Tuesday by 8 p.m. Every Tuesday by 8 p.m. If you have missed it, you can join us next week. So what? Have faith in God. Jesus said in the book of Matthew 11, verse 22 to 23. Through the scripture, there is one word that is common throughout the entire scripture, that even your belief in God depends on it. Because without it, your belief is vanity. Because the Bible makes it clear to us that if you come to God, you must first believe that God is God. There is no point going to church every Sunday, sitting down in a group, when you don't believe that God exists, that he is God in the first place, and that he is able to do that which he promised, and he is able to do exceedingly above anything you can think, ask, or even imagine. Without faith, congregational church will look like a religious gathering. The only thing that makes a difference between a religious gathering and a Christian fellowship is faith. Faith brings Christ's reality, Christ's truths, into a religious worship. Because without faith, every gathering of Christians is just a religious ceremony. So that is why faith is mandatory in Christianity. Because if you come to God, you must first of all believe that the God you have come to exists and is able to do what you are asking of him. If not, why do we pray? If you go on your knees every day, the only expectation of going to your knees is that you expect the prayer to be answered. If you don't believe your prayer will be answered, why do we pray? So how is your prayer different from the people offering sacrifice to idol? If you don't believe your sacrifice will be received, why should you keep offering them? Have faith in God. Jesus said, I tell you the truth. If any one of you says to this mountain, go. He didn't say faith is not discriminatory. Faith does not say it applies to A, B is minus from it. Faith is mandatory for every believer. But there is limitation according to our understanding of it. The more knowledge of the Word of God you have, the greater the faith you possess. If your understanding is small, your faith will be small. But if your understanding about God and your confidence in Him is great, your faith will be a great faith or strong faith. So if anyone says to this mountain, he didn't say if a pastor says to this mountain, or if a group of people say to this mountain, or if a community says to this mountain, or if a government says to this mountain, but he say if any one of us, that means faith is a business of I, not we. Faith is not a group thing. Faith is an individual reality. You must know God for yourself before you can present him to others. You cannot know God as a group. You have to know him, have a personal encounter with him. That is what faith is about. If anyone says to this mountain, it doesn't matter how the size of the mountain is, but it depends on the one that is bold enough to speak out. Faith conquers fear. Faith makes fear look small. When fear knocks at your doors of disbelief, reply to fear with faith and confidence. And it says, if any one of us have the ability, in Matthew chapter 11, verse 22 to 23, it says, if any one of us can say to this mountain, go, throw yourself into the sea. Does it say we have to move it with some tractors or some excavators? No. He said, we can say to the mountain, throw yourself into the sea. And that person does not doubt in his heart that what he says will happen. It will be done for him. The confidence you have as a believer is that whatever you say with your mouth, God is able to perform. Whatever you say with your mouth, God is able to perform. Like a little girl that says to Nehemiah in the Bible, that behold, be of good cheer, sir, I believe in God. Be of good courage. His master was a commander, an army general. The little girl comforted him that it should be of good cheer, that I believe in God. It shall be done to you even according to my words. That is faith. Faith blows out of a heart of understanding. That's why the Bible makes us understand that faith comes from understanding. What do you understand? The testimony of what God has done. Faith does not come from reading theological book. Faith does not come from service attendance. If not, some doctors of theology would have been the greatest miracle worker of our time. Faith does not come from having PhD in divinity. Faith does not come from knowledge you have by reading through Bible like textbook. Faith comes by understanding. And how is that understanding fruitful? By hearing it. How did you hear? You hear because someone preached to you. Look at the woman at the well in Samaria. This woman came to fetch water. Jesus said, give me water to drink. And the woman said, how can you, being a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, to give you water to drink? For the Jews have no dealing with Samaritan. But Jesus looked at her and said, if you understand the gift of God and the person that asks water of you, you would have asked of him. Remember, Jesus said he needed water to drink. And this woman refused because it's uncommon for a Jew to ask a Samaritan for water. But on the other hand, Jesus said to the same woman, if you know the gift of God, you would have asked of him. He would have given you the living water. Then the woman was surprised. Sir, you don't have bucket. And you don't have anything to draw. The well we are looking at is very deep. Where are you going to get that living water that you want to give me? And Jesus looked at her and said, whoever drink of this well and this water, he will get thirsty again. But whoever drink of the water I shall give him will never thirst. That water will be in him a springs of everlasting water, springing up into everlasting life. Jesus was obviously not talking about the waters in the world. He was talking about the Holy Spirit, which the Father will give to them that believes in him. And that this gift will be poured upon those who believe. And that this gift will not run dry for everlasting to everlasting. It will bootstrap their faith. And the Holy Spirit will teach them hidden things of God. And make impossibility possible by believing. The Holy Spirit activates your faith to reality. It takes the Spirit of God to act on the surface of your faith and convert the things that are impossible to possibility. So that's why when we pray for the sick, how many people praying for the sick knew that the sick would get well? Not me. I've prayed for many sick, many demons cast out. But I never believed when I was praying that, oh, by just laying hand, that my prayer is going to heal the sick or cast out the devil. No. When I pray, I rely on God's word because I believe that he that said it is able to perform. And so I have that confidence. Because the Bible says he that come to God must believe that God is what? God. And one, he is able to reward them that diligently seek him. And so because of that confidence I have in God, when I pray, I lay my hands on the sick. Then I simply pray. It can be a short prayer of as even our Father. Then I withdrew my hands. Suddenly, the Spirit of God act upon that word and drive away the sickness because of the confidence of belief. Because fear can be sensed 5,000 miles away. And the Spirit of God does not respond to fear. It does not move to because you cry, because of your tears. It moves because you have confidence in God. It's just like when a child is being pursued. Your father might just be 2.5 inches man that is very weak and he cannot even lift a wood. But when a child is being pursued by somebody out there, he ran towards the direction of his father, hoping that his father would deliver him. He doesn't know whether his father has the power or the strength to confront what is coming, but he believes, as long as he's my father, he is able to defend me in everything. That is the same confidence we believers have in God. That when we are being pursued by sickness, being pursued by affliction, being pursued by pain, being pursued by poverty, being pursued by the desire and the lust of the things of this world, we have confidence that when we run into the hands of the Lord. Because why do we have that confidence? Because he told us in his word that the name of God is a strong tower, that the righteous runs in so is, and they are saved. And so because we knew his name is a strong tower, so when we run towards his direction, we are saved. It doesn't matter the size of the enemy. That was why small youths like David could stand in front of Almighty Goliath and could say, you come against me with bow, with spear, and with arrow, but I have nothing in my hand except some sling and a piece of 5 smooth stone I picked from this very valley. But I come to you in the name of the God of hosts, by whose God you have defied his army this day, and I will take your head from thee. And his word came to pass. It is not the strength in David's sling. It is not his strength in his hand. It's not the experience he has in battle. But he believes in God. That was the same reason why the children of Israel sent 12 spies to look at the land of Canaan. Out of the 12, only 2 came back with good report. Because the rest saw it like everyone on the earth saw trouble. They look at it, this trouble is too big that it cannot be fixed. The other one look at it, oh yes, the fruits are good like God said, but the inhabitants, the way the food is big, that is how the inhabitants are big. The land is the land that eats its inhabitants. There are giants there. Even the son of Anak are there. We were like grasshopper in our sight when we saw those giants. And so were we even in the eyes of those giants. And the Lord said, as you have said with your eyes, so will I do unto you. There is nothing God hates more than in the life of a Christian than unbelief. And you know the good news today? Every unbelief is a belief. Only it has on the back. Because of the on the back, the things you ask in prayer will not be done. People don't get saved because they pray. People get saved because they believe in God.
Nobody cast out demons by prayer. People cast out demons by faith. Because the devil is going to withhold a little while and stay a bit longer to prove actually if what you are saying, you mean it. If you actually understand the scripture you are quoting, what it stands for. If you are actually ready to defend your belief. The sons of Sevier, they went into a demon with the same name of Jesus that Paul preaches. What happened? The demon bounced on them and beat them out, boot naked. One thing was different from Paul, because Paul knew the God he was serving. Even the demon testified. He said, that Paul you just spoke about, I know him. Jesus, I know him. But you, who are you? Because you don't even know what you are saying. And you don't even believe in what you are quoting. That is what happens when religious leaders confront a devil. Because when you confront her, the critic is going to ask you, I know the Jesus you call. I know that man of God that dragged me out yesterday. But you, who are you? One, three things ensured your faith are driven to reality. One, a life of constant commitment, belief. Your belief must be consistent. As a Christian, you don't just believe once. Your life should be a days of faith. You live by faith, not by sight. The Bible says, how does the just live? Does the just live by how much money they have in their pocket? Do they live by how much bonds they have in the banks? Do they live by how much challenges that is less? Or present situation they find themselves? No, they just live by faith. They live by confidence in God, turning impossibility to possibility, because they knew fully well if they have earthly father, their earthly father will not say move from Benin to Lagos without giving the transport. So is God. God will not send you into a battle he knows you cannot win. If God tells you go through the sea, he know that he can part the Red Sea. If God said to you, walk over Jordan, he know he can drain up Jordan. He is not sending you on an impossible mission. Stop telling God, what you send me is impossible. God took a servant of his into the valley of dry bones. What is as impossible as dry bones? And God asked him a simple question. Son of man, can this bone live? And God is asking you a question tonight that you have to set your heart to answer. And he's saying, son, can this your death situation live? Can this job that looks impossible to get, can you get it? Can this journey that looks almost unobtainable, can you make it? God is asking you a question. God does not ask you a question because he doesn't know the answer. God asks you a question to stir up your faith. You know why? Because faith comes by hearing. And hearing comes from the word of God. Through faith, I have seen amazing things happen in my short terms in the ministry with faith. I have seen people receive instant freedom with faith. I have seen demon cast out with faith. Sick healed with faith. People grow overnight with faith. I have seen barren women receive children with faith. That is because faith is a belief. Counter your unbelief, sister. Even when they tell you, oh, this thing is just practically impossible. Like the case I had in Germany. He said, could you believe the pastor said to me, I am bewitched eating my children. And I look at the woman and I said, the one you didn't eat, you will deliver them. That is what faith says. Faith does not say impossibility. Faith see possibility. And I say, shall we pray? Just 1 month, she said, pastor, I am pregnant. 1 month after 15 years of marriage. Do you know why? Without faith, it is impossible to please God. If you come to God, you must believe. First of all, sometimes you deliberately set barrier by the leading of the Holy Spirit on the person forward. It is not the pastor that is doing it. The Holy Spirit deliberately stir up barrier to build your faith for expectation. so that you can receive. Like in the case of this lady, I stood as a barrier to her. I asked her a simple question. She said that, can't you pray for me? I said, no. Do you know what? That I'm going to some office. That office is more important than your case. And she said, are you telling me just ordinary paperwork is more important than being without a charge for 15 years? I say yes. He said, okay, I'll follow you to that office. When you finish, you will pray for me. I said, no problem. Let us go. She followed me to the office. I waited, and I finished with everything. He said, now, can you pray for me? I said, no, go and fast for 3 days. And I will fast for 3 days. And the third day, we will pray. She said, you have one problem. I cannot fast till more than 12 o'clock. I say, it's enough. I said, you fast for till 12, and I will fast the remaining 3 days, and we will pray. On the third day we met together, I said, Father, you said in your word there is no barren in the land. That word could have been said 3 days ago. That word could have been said the very minute I met her. But God deliberately, because without faith it is impossible to please God. God wants to stir up the faith of the receiver. But because the faith was not growing enough, God wants to build it up. Because when people do not have faith, they cannot receive. So what do? Borrow them your faith. Deliberately set obstacles, like what Jesus did to the woman. And he said, my daughter is first vexed. Come and heal my daughter. And the Lord Jesus said, look at her. He said, it is wrong to give the children bread to dogs. If it were you and I, we would be offended. We would walk away disappointed. Are you calling me a dog? Are you saying I'm not qualified to receive God's blessing because I'm not from the stock of the Hebrew? But that was not what Jesus was doing. Jesus deliberately sets that obstacle to build up her faith to receive. And the woman looked at Jesus and said, Master, yes, you are right. But even the dog eat the crumbs that fall from the master table. She was determined to get her miracle, and she did get it. And Jesus said, marvel, and said, I have not seen even such faith, not even in Israel. God is saying to you today, obstacles are deliberately set. It is not to break you. That's why the Bible chastises. The Bible says to us, it says, if you be without chastisement, you are not son, you are bastard. Any children that will be sons unto the Father, they need chastisement. You must be chastised. The chastisement is not a punishment. It's a moment of bootstrapping your faith so that you can receive the required grace needed to obtain your miracle. That's why the Bible makes it clear that long-suffering is one of the fruit of the Spirit. Because without long-suffering, you cannot get patience. And without patience, you cannot get endurance. And without endurance, you can never have perfectness. Christians who wish to be perfect must first of all learn to endure. Now, before we continue today, I want us to just say a short prayer. Say, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you mark sin against my life, stopping my progress. I speak to you and I command you to move right now in the name of Jesus. Amen. Just that simple prayer can remove mountains from your life. It can remove mountains from your vision. It can remove mountains from your business. If only it is said with faith. The greatest miracle I have ever done in my life, the prayer did not take 3 hours. It's less than 6 minutes. So it is not how long you can spend on your knees. Faith does not come by prayer. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. The only way sick can be healed is to send the word of God. When you send the word of God, the sick will be healed. The Bible says he sent his word. It did not say he sent his prayer. No, he sent his word. And his word, what? Did the healing. If you have been hearing the message of God every Sunday, and you still need somebody to lay hand on your head before you get up from your wheelchair, there is something wrong with you. The word you have received is enough. Tonight, God says, I should tell you that your word you have received is more than able to do or to change that situation. What is faith? The simple answer is found in Hebrews 11, verse 6. Hebrews 11, verse 6. What does it say? For without faith, it is impossible to please God. That means, without faith, you can't call yourself a Christian. Some people say, I'm just a Christian, but you know, I cannot have faith. Everybody cannot have faith. If you don't have faith, you are not a Christian. You are a religious, you are a good person. Yes, obviously, you are very good. Religious people are good people. They dress holy, they wear holy robe, they look nice, they look beautiful, because they are good people. But that doesn't make them Christian. What makes you a Christian is to act like Christ. Christ acts in faith. So you cannot be a Christian without having faith. If you don't have confidence that when Christ returns, you will be like him, and you will ascend to heaven as he did, you are not a Christian. You might go to church, attend social gathering every Sunday or every weekday. You might even be the largest donor in your church. All your donors are for the minister. None of them will take you to heaven. But faith is what saved you. You can pay half of your life as tithe. Without faith, that money you are hoping for, you will not get it. You can give yourself to be burnt. Share all you want for God's place. All those things we do is that they will protect your assets, but you will not get the one. You will not be able to stand up in a project that is mightier than you are. You will not be able to say like David, I will not give sleep to my eyes. I will not go into my chamber until I find a house, a place for the God of David. Until I found a house for my God. That was David. He stood up. He said, I cannot sleep. Now I have finished all this victory in the name of God. Will I go home to my house? When this ark of God dwell in tent, say no. I will find it in the feet of Jah. God saw that his heart was determined. God had to stop him. God had to send a message personally to David that he will not build my house. But I will raise your son. He will do the building. That is God. Because Abraham, today, would all of us want to be ascribed as sons and daughters of Abraham. Not because Abraham was just the patriarch in Israel, because he believes. He believes to the end to in God without asking questions. He counts that even God was able to raise Isaac from the dead, even when he knew fully well that killing Isaac, he was past the age of childbearing. He believed that if I waited 100 years for Isaac, even when every man told me it cannot be done, that God is able to raise up another Isaac from the same Sarah, even from the grave. He had that confidence. And because of that, he who received his sacrifice gave his only begotten son. Today, through Christ, we all are sons of Abraham. We now have confidence in him. Because through Christ, the promise that he will be the father of many nations was given to us through that righteousness that comes from faith. You cannot even claim to be righteous if you do not have faith. Because righteousness comes from faith. The righteousness that grace provides can only be given through faith. What did John 3:16 tell us? It says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. The son has been given on behalf of who? Who did Christ die for? The whole world, the whole human race. Is the whole human race saved? No. Why? If he died for the whole human race, why is everybody not saved? Why can't everybody be free? The simple truth is, remember what was said in the end of 3:16. Whosoever believes, whosoever have confidence, the doors of grace is open. Jesus said in Revelation, I stand at the doors and knock. Christ is knocking on the door of every heart, whether the good, the bad, the ugly. The question is choice. The choice to believe. If you can dare to believe, you can dare to receive. But if you cannot dare to have confidence in the God of Abraham, you can still go to church. You can still marry on the altar, wear a Christian robe, but you are not a Christian. You are a religious person, a devoted religious servant of God. It doesn't matter your religion. It doesn't matter your tribe. It doesn't matter what you pray to. But as long as it is not built on faith, it has no founding in God. Faith is what makes us children of God. Faith is what brings us into the trees of adoption. Faith is what binds us to the body of Christ. There is no ambassador that can be a true ambassador if he does not show the power and the grace of his country. If you say you are a citizen of heaven, you should be able to show some work that comes from heaven. If not, nobody will believe in you. Remember when Jesus preached to the Pharisees, they said, what sign will you show us that we may believe? Our father gave manna in the wilderness. So they saw that the only thing that made and then separate Moses to them as a child of God was because he brought manna from heaven. And Jesus had to give them a contrary message that your father did not give you manna, but my father was the one who gave you the real manna. I am the bread that came from heaven. If any man eats my flesh and drink my blood, that same man has eternal life. Because my flesh is bread indeed, and my blood is wine indeed. And that was when they became too hard for so many of them. And they left. They could no longer walk with him. You once had message, and you got had message, and now you are running away. Because without faith, you cannot understand the things of the Spirit. The Bible makes it clear to us in the book of 1 Corinthians that a carnal man, 2 Corinthians, a carnal man cannot know the things of the Spirit because they are foolishness in his eyes. He cannot design it because they are spiritually designed. Don't bring faith to somebody that doesn't have the Spirit of God. You'll be speaking in a mystery. And that mystery, he cannot comprehend. The difference between you and the devil is not because you know the scripture, because the devil knows the scripture back and front. The difference between you and demon is not because you don't possess people. The difference is faith. They know the scripture. They know Jesus Christ. They know he is the Son of God. They know all the prophecies, but they don't know how to bring faith into reality. Because faith can only inhabit a spirit-filled child of God. And you cannot hear and apply without the Holy Spirit. That was why Jesus said to the disciple, you have been parted. You have learned from me all this year. You have seen my work, but do not go out. Stay in Jerusalem. Why would they stay in Jerusalem? Until they be endowed with the Spirit from above. Until the Holy Spirit imbibe you, the face of God cannot make sense to you. Because you are carnal. And because you are carnal, you cannot have faith. Until you are empowered with the Holy Spirit, faith cannot proceed. Because when ever you come to the brink of faith, your salvation will fail. Doubt will set in. But the Bible says when we don't know how to pray, for no human being can ever pray as he's supposed to pray, to bring situation to reality. The Spirit of God always intercedes on our behalf. Because when we don't know how to pray for something as we're supposed to, God himself helps our infirmities. He knew we are weak. He knew we were made from dust. Then he brings in his Spirit into our heart, crying, Abba, Father. What is he saying? You are a child of God through faith. And that child of God through faith gives you the confidence to confront evil, gives you the confidence to make impossibility possible. That confidence through faith brings the mind of God into the situation, and you see yourself escalating the spirit, and you bring God's dominions into the realms of the physical. That's why Christian should live a life of faith. Don't live the life of how much I have. I cannot afford it today because I don't have enough money. I cannot get to the mission field because God has not provided money through donation for the mission. No. Faith is you can start the mission field from where you are. And when you start, God will empower it. He will bring you to your desired heaven. God sends you on evangelism on the trip to Lagos. Before you get to Lagos and you do not have money to go to Lagos, start in the street. What did God say you should go and do in Lagos? Evangelize. Are there people where you are? Yes. Start by preaching to those people. And when you are preaching, say, God, yes, you send me to Lagos, but I don't have transport yet. So I'm preaching to these people. And the Lord will say, okay, that bus driver just preached to him. And the Lord driver will say, there is this free space in the back. Sit down. Before you know, you will be in Lagos. It is not because you have the money for transport. It is because you have confidence in God. And faith goes with Christ's mandate. You may have all faith that you can remove mountain, but if you do not ask, seek, and knock, it will not be open unto you. You must, with your faith, ask. Ask for what you need. You need job? Ask God. Just ask. A friend of mine said to me, he said, one time, you know, a friend needed a generator, and he came to a place where they don't have enough money for even the generator. And he was busy about needed generator desperately, but there is no money. Then he came to him, he said, have you asked God? Have you asked God? He said, then they knelt down and they asked God. Before they finished asking God, somebody said, I wanted to go to Abuja, I want to pack, but I have only one problem. He said, what problem is that, sir? He said, the generator. The generator is the problem. It's too big, I cannot carry it. Will you sell it, sir? He said, yes. How much will you sell it? He said, what type of generator? He said, it's a plant. And exactly what the church was looking for. He said, how much will you sell it? He said, well, if you can give me anything, it's okay. We'll offer you about 300,000. He said, come and take it. And that was not even onto one tenth of what that generator would have cost. God offered the generator to them at a lower price. Why? Because they prayed. Sometimes Christians complain rather than pray. Even when some go on their knees, 24 hours they kneel down a day and they complain to God. God, you know the children have not eaten. God, you know I have been applying for jobs since 20 years. God, you know my mother has been sick. No healing. God, you know some even curse God on their name. Some question God on their name rather than pray. The Bible says, whatsoever thing you ask in prayer, believe that you have them. What? Whenever you go on your knees to pray, believe that you already have what you ask. And you will have them. How? With human beings, this is impossible. How can I believe that I am well when my leg still feels hot? How do I believe that I am well when the headache and the pain is still there? How do I believe that I am well when the person in question is not even able to move the arm? Faith comes by belief and confidence. I will give you an instance from a man of God in this scripture. What did he do? He was in such situation as we were. He said to a man whose name was Ahab. Go home. Go now and eat and drink, because you have done what God said you should do. Go now and eat and drink. This is after 3.5 years of no rain. He said, go now and eat and drink, because there is a sound of abundance of rain. He said it. Does the face of the sky change? No. Was there dew? No. Was there sign of rain? No. Not before he said it, not after he said it. But he said it is a sign of abundance of rain. What did he do? He went, he put his head between his knee and bowed his head to God in prayer. And he said to the servant, now I am praying, you go and watch. That is how prayer works. Pray and watch. How do you know that God has healed the cripple when you just pray? You refuse to lift the cripple up. How do you know that God has raised the dead when you just stay there and say, in Jesus' name, oh, you dead, I command you to raise? No. Why not take him by the hand and say, Talitha kumi, rise, little girl, or rise, young man? Why not stand your ground? Do it the same way Jesus did it. Copy is allowed. Prove God. God did not say try me, he said prove me. Prove that I can do it. If you dare to prove, you want proof that God exists, lay your hand upon the sick. Do it the same way Jesus did it and get the same result that Jesus gets. He said all these things. He did not say you will do less. He said all these things you see me do. Greater thing than all this you will do. Do you know why? When I was with you, I was still on earth. Now I'm going to my Father, where I will be able to answer all your prayer. So do greater things. But Christians are still struggling to do even the things he did. Do you know what? Unbelief. Unbelief. The disciple of Jesus Christ came to Jesus and they said, a man came to Jesus and said, I brought my servant to your disciple when you were not around. He is sick with passion. He is neurotic. Sometimes the spirit sought to destroy him. He cast him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. I brought this charge to your disciple, but they could not heal him. And Jesus said, bring him to me. What? Who is Jesus said they should bring? Somebody that is mad. Somebody that fall into the fire. That was his qualification. Somebody that fall into the water. That is who Jesus said they should bring. And he cast the demon out with a word. And when the disciple came, when the man has left, the disciple came to him and said, how come we could not do what you just did? Jesus did not say to them, because you did not come to church last week, or because you did not fast for 3 months, or because you did not wear a priest's garment, or because you did not attend Bible school. No. Because of your unbelief. If you believe in God, you can do all things. If you just have faith as a grain of mustard seed, it's enough to raise the dead. It's enough to move mountain that is immovable and cause them to move. Just that little faith is enough. Faith in Hebrews 6 says that you must believe that God is what? Real. God must be a real God in your life. Not some God you read about in the Bible. Not the God in the book of Isaiah. Not the God in the book of Jeremiah. It should be the God in the life of Collins. It should be the God in your own family. It should be your own personal God. The Lord, my God. Not our God. Remember one thing that shocked me in that particular place. Saying, why would we? Were we not able to cast him out? We, not I. We. All of us, we not cast out one demon that we drove out with a word. The journey of faith is not collective, it's one. Decree a thing and it shall come to pass, and light will shine upon your word, not our word. Decree a thing, it will come to pass. So it doesn't matter what situation you find yourself, you can decree a thing and it will come to pass. And God says something here in Hebrews 11 verse 6, is which says, you must believe that God is what? Real. He is a rewarder of them that what? Diligently seek him. If you seek God diligently, you will receive the help you are looking for. How did it happen? Sometime in Africa long ago, I was in a mission field and I met a little child who came to me and he said to me, on popular demand, not like what other people I have prayed with ask. The church came to me when I asked him, what do you want from God? He looked healthy, he looked nice, and I don't ever think the church should need anything. He doesn't look sick. And he came to me, and I look at the church. I say, what do you want from God? He said, I want to be free. My leg tinkled within me. That is the first time someone have ever asked me such a question. Then, instantly, I receive a convincement from the Holy Spirit. I look at the child. I said, look at me. His eyes automatically focus in me, expecting to receive something. Then I knew at that point, there was enough faith to receive what he asked. The next thing I said, I am free. Embrace me and receive your own freedom. That was all. Instantly, the child was free. Why? Faith transformed spiritual events of things you do not see into physical reality. Faith does not act on your emotion. Faith does not act on your internal thinking or motivation. So when you think about situation, God may not actually be there. It's like when you are laying your hand upon the sick. You don't lay your hand on the sick and you put your hand there and wait until you check the temperature, that the temperature is falling before you remove your hand. Your hand is not medicine. Your hand is not stethoscope. Your hand is not x-ray machine. Your hand does not do the healing. God do the healing. Command things that are not as though they are. And wait and believe for it to come to reality. How does the heaven and earth we see today appear? Did they tell you that God took a ruler and pencil and some concrete mixer and begin to mix the foundation of the earth or use some block for the construction? He declared his word and it came to pass. And he has given you that same ability. The Bible says, God bring the beast to Adam. Whatever name he calleth the name of that beast, that was the name for henceforth. It doesn't matter what situation you find yourself. Give it a name. What name are you ready to call your trouble? What name are you ready to call your vision? What name are you ready to call all the trouble that has plagued you throughout your lifetime? What name are you ready to give to the situation that looks almost unpackable? Call sorrow blessing. And that is the name it will bear from henceforth. If you can only dare to believe. The name you call is the names it will bear. If you call it trouble, you will bear trouble. If you call it joy, you will bear joy. The Bible says even when you are passing through the valley of Baca, you can convert it into a well of water. You can convert it and say, oh, you blessings, Receive strength. You will see strength come from nowhere. God will gradually strengthen you. Your pocket is empty. Prophesy to that pocket and command it to be filled rather than focus on yourself. I remember once upon a time in my life, I was in the street of Holland, no persons. The person that invited me there abandoned me. No job, nothing. I look up to God in heaven. I cried to him. But nothing, no sound, no voice. I begin to fast to preserve the little food I have. God did not send help until the last piece of food was spent. Then I said, God, I wait for you. Do your wonders. Suddenly, somebody showed up from nowhere. And the Lord took me away from that situation. And preserved my life. And gave me hope in the midst of hopelessness. God is more than able to do what you can think, ask, or even imagine. There is nobody that said, Father, help me, that God did not help. Hagar was crying. He dumped his child in front. I don't want to see the death of my child. But he never knew there was a well in his front. Because fear blinds your eyes. The blessing in front of you. Don't always think when you pray, God is going to manufacture healing. The healing you are praying for already exists. It's already there. All God is waiting for you to do is speak it forth. Decree it and it will come to pass. And cause light to shine upon your ways. That is what God expected from us. Believer must be confident that God is able to perform what he has said. God is not a man. He is not a man that he should lie. And God is not the son of man that he should repent concerning what he has said. Has God said anything in your life? Will he not be able to do it? Has he ever made a promise? Will he not be able to perform it? God is not a man that he should lie. Brethren, this is where the teaching becomes more interesting. You must understand, in Hebrews 11, verse 1 to 39, we have to understand that the word in verse 3 was framed by the word of God. This heaven and earth, you and I stand upon daily. Forget all the nonsense theory quoted by science. Nobody can put a bomb into a jump feed and expect a new plane or car to be created from it. Nobody can explode an organism in the universe and expect a new earth to be created. The Big Bang Theory is a myth. I'm a scientist. I read science, but the Big Bang Theory is a myth. Coupled together for scientists who doesn't know what they're saying. We can worship as Abel did. Abel believes in God. Even death did not stop him from achieving reality. He was dead, his blood spoke. We can please God as Enoch did by having confidence in God despite the fall that he was not seen. You know why? God took him. We can avoid disaster as saving our family as Enoch did if we have faith. We can receive the call of God and obey as Abraham did. Leave your father's house to a land you do not know, to a destination you have no idea, to a land that I will show you. There I will make you a great nation. He did not say, God, where are we going? Which direction? He obeyed and he went, not knowing where he went. He cast his own way behind him. And one thing was common. He stood still. He saw the salvation of the Lord. And the Lord is saying to you tonight, relax, for God will do it. Relax, no matter whatever situation you find yourself in. Learn to relax, for God will do. When you are agitated as a believer, God is not there. Christians don't get agitated when things get bad. Christians don't get confused when situation does not mirror their desire. Christians put their way behind them. They put their care to Christ. They take all their problems to the feet of Jesus. And they leave it there. Because the Bible says, if they trust and never doubt, God will bring them out. God is more than able to bring them out. Tonight, we can do what is physically impossible as Sarah did. Sarah was past menopause. He was past the age of childbearing, but he bare a seed when he was old. Even to the extent when the angel said, I will return by this time of life, by this time next year, and Sarah will have a child. Sarah burst into laughter. How is this going to be possible? Are these people mocking me because they have too much wine? No, God does not mock concerning his promise. And that's why God gave Isaac laughter, because Sarah laughed. And Sarah heard of it, himself who received it, he said, the Lord has made me to laugh. And anybody that hear of this will laugh with me. Indeed, God will make you to laugh today. And anybody that will hear of what God will do in your life, the person will laugh with you. We can know the end of age is near and play our part in God's calendar, as Daniel did from verse 13 to 16. We can sacrifice our best knowing God is faithful and is able to provide, as Abraham did. And counting it that God was able even to raise up Isaac from the grave, we can walk away from sin and see the invisible God as Moses did. The Bible says that all these people were still living by faith when they died. They believe in God, even at the point of death. That's why, to me, I don't see impossibility. Because if anything on earth I cast my mind to do, nothing is restrained from me. Because I have one mind with God. And I believe in him. And I believe with God, nothing. When I mean nothing, I mean absolutely nothing shall be impossible. These were all commended for their faith. Although none of them received what they have been promised. Abraham died in faith. He did not receive the promise. But he saw it afar off. He believed in God. Against hope, he believed in hope. That is what faith is about. Faith is not for 3 years. Faith is not for 10 years. Faith is forever. We can sacrifice our best knowing God is faithful, as Abraham did. We can walk away from sin and seeing the invisible God as Moses did. Bible says that all these people still have faith when they died, and that these were all commended for their faith. Though none of them receive what they have been promised yet. Faith is calling out to God. What happened to the people who were lost in life? Psalm 107, verse 4 to 9. And to the people that were lost in sin, in verse 10 to 16. The people lost in sickness, 17 to 22. And even to the people who got lost in the perilous journey in the sea, they have confidence in God, and they cried unto God, and God brought them out of their distresses, and he brought them to their desire, and the sea was stilled, and the wave thereof were hushed, and they sacrificed and gave thanks unto the Lord, because there was calmness in the sea. Where does faith come from? There is saving faith, the gift of God. In Ephesians 2 verse 8, time will not permit us to read. Let's just
Hurriedly read Ephesians 2 verse 8. It said, for by grace you have been saved through faith. That is not of yourself, it is the gift of God. You were saved by grace because you have faith in God, ability to do the impossible. You cannot be saved except you have faith. Faith is the saving grace for believer. Second Timothy 1 verse 6. Faith of God brings forgiveness of sin. Let's read 2 Timothy chapter 1 verse 6. It says, therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of hands. Laying on of my hands, that God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. God has not given us the spirit of fear. The only thing that resists a Christian from doing what is right is fear. You saw the sick. You want to drive out that sickness. You hate the sickness. You hate everything that comes with sickness. You hate affliction you see in God's people. God created you to change things. Instead of looking for who to blame, some even go as far as blaming God for their woes. Why not stand your ground in faith and decree things and it will come to pass? The Bible says God did not give you the spirit of fear. The spirit he gave you, the spirit of boldness, the spirit of love, and of soundness of faith. Confidence. Faith comes by what? Hearing. What do you want to hear? The voice of God. Moses could not part the sea until he heard the voice of God. Hearing the word that comes from God. Because some people say, how then do I have faith? God is not speaking to me. The Holy Spirit speaks to your heart every day. And if you can hear what the Spirit says to the church, that says spirits that quickened the Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, that says spirit, if he rests in you, he will quicken your mortal body and he will make the impossibility become possible for you. Hearing. How do you hear the word of God? Through the word. We have a more sure word of prophecy, the Bible, the word of God. Preaching from pastors, instead of spending 24 hours watching some movie that does not benefit, spend 30 minutes on Bible teachings, listening to men of God who through faith have shaped destiny. If you heard somebody did it, then you know it can be done. That is how faith shapes the destiny of great men of God. When you listen to other people, command the lion mind to stop. When you listen to others, take on giants that are twice their size. When you hear it, it stirs up your faith, and the Spirit of God interprets that faith and transforms it into reality. You grow from weakness to strength. There is no weak man in God's Canada. God chose most of us, the most defied thing of this world, to confront the things that are holy. God choose most of us, the things that are weak, that are nothing, things that does not even exist, to confront the things that are. And how does this thing come? It comes by God teaching us hearing of faith. I remember when the angel sat me down in a chair to teach me faith,
And the next thing I heard was that faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things you have not seen. That was all. I have to do the remaining study by myself. Tapes and books that of great men of God, who through faith stopped the mouth of lions, raised up the dead, read about them. Study the word of God, and your faith will grow from there. There is a gift of faith. It's not automatic. It still needs to be built upon. The gift of faith exists in most of us, but we still have to grow it. Even when you don't panic, that does not mean every sick will be healed. It means you have ability to believe more. Faith means believing in your heart, because you cannot be saved except you first believe from the heart, and then confession is made from the mouth. Faith is first, is the same thing in salvation. Faith is first believing from the heart, then confessing it from the mouth. The Bible says, I believe, therefore I speak. I have confidence in God, therefore I command it. Ezekiel says, I prophesy as I was commanded. God spoke to me, and I believe from my heart that what he says are true. Therefore, I prophesy it with my mouth as I was commanded. Today, you can still prophesy those things that God has commanded you to do. You can prophesy as you were commanded, and the impossibility will become possible. We are body, soul, and spirit. First Thessalonians 5, verse 23. But because God is a spirit, John 4, verse 24, we believe him in our spirit, by the word of our hearts. The heart is the home of one living faith, and such is God's foundation of our mind, which is the reservoir of learning and human knowledge, the brain. Mark 11, verse 23 to 24, Romans 10, 10, Hebrews 23, verse 23, tells us, buy the truth and don't sell it. Buy the truth and don't sell it. Meaning the truth has a price, and that price may be believing God's promises. That's why I love the song, standing on the promises of God that cannot fail. Standing on the promises of God that cannot fail. Stand on it. In all contrary circumstances, when the storm of life comes, if you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. Through the water, it will not overwhelm you. Sometimes an educated but unspiritual mind will sell God truth and grasp for human alternative, which in fact, that alternative should be put in the place behind active believing faith in God's words. Paul, an intellectual genius of his days, declared that we are to live by faith, not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7. The just shall live by faith. Martin Luther, throughout his life, believed a life test. How shall the just live? By faith. We can only live with the confidence of faith. Brother, this is where we caught this topic today. I'm sorry we could not run the topic. It's a bit too wide. A life of faith. And I pray to God, if you are part of our school, you have opportunity to complete the remaining training. God bless you as you participate. Brethren, we hope to see you again next week. Now let us pray. Let me pray for you. Tonight, whatever is that situation you want God to lift, just put your hand in that situation. If it is not tangible situation, it's a spiritual situation,
cast your mind upon it and believe in God with me that it is taken away. And let's see what God will do. It shall be taken away instantly, right now, by the authority in the blood of Jesus. I command every body to be lifted. I command every sick to be healed. I command those in pain to receive instant relief. I command those that are cast down to be lifted up. I command those that their situation are deemed irredeemable to receive instant grace. I command the impossibility in your life to become possible. I command joblessness to become jobbed. I command poverty to become financial prosperity. I command the weak to become strong. I command a doubtful mind to become filled with faith. Receive the grace to do the impossible. For in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Brethren, if you miss any of our topic, you can still watch out on cgfnslogin.app or go to our page on CGF. You can still check out on CGF Open Heart Fellowship or Christian Pastoral Fellowship Group on Facebook. You will be able to see this teaching and watch it again. God bless you. And if you are part of our group, we'll always send you the link. God bless you as you participate.